Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm John Geschke, partner at the law firm of Cooley Gogwer Cronish, and your chair for tonight's program. Tonight's program is a part of a series of programs underwritten by the Geschke family, which examines the U.S. Constitution in the 21st century. Since the September 11th, 2001 al-Qaeda attacks on the World Trade Center and the Pentagon, the U.S. has been on the equivalent of a wartime footing. This period of time has given rise to specific legislation and practices that present significant challenges to the core provisions of the U.S. Constitution, protecting civil liberties and freedom of speech. Walking the line between protecting U.S. security and curbing the rights of U.S. citizens is a delicate business. A government's first duty is to protect its citizens against threats to its to their security. Yet starting down the path of restricting civil liberties can be a very slippery slope. The Commonwealth Club's series on the U.S. Constitution in the 21st century will examine the balance between safety, security, and the public order on one hand, and the protection of civil liberties and the integrity of the Constitution on the other. This series aims to break new ground by delving into recent interpretations of the U.S. Constitution and discussing potential new directions for the Obama administration. To this end, it's now my pleasure to introduce tonight's distinguished speaker, H. Thomas Wells, President of the American Bar Association, who will tonight discuss challenges to preserving the integrity of America's court system. Mr. Wells is a partner and founding member of the law firm of Maynard, Cooper & Gale in Birmingham, Alabama. Mr. Wells' litigation practice includes an emphasis on complex environmental, toxic tort law, and products liability cases. He's also a frequent speaker and participant in state and national programs dealing with trial and litigation issues. In addition to his current role as president of the ABA, Mr. Wells has served on numerous committees and in leadership roles in the Alabama State Bar, the Birmingham Bar Association, and the American Bar Association, including as chair of the ABA's House of Delegates and chair of the ABA's litigation section. Mr. Wells also served as co-chair of the ABA's Special Committee on Disaster Response, which was commissioned after the devastation of Hurricane Katrina. Mr. Wells is a two-time graduate of the University of Alabama, earning both his bachelor's degree and law degree with honors from that institution. Please join me in welcoming H. Thomas Wells.
Thank you, John. I appreciate that fine introduction. I will have to admit it was better than the introduction I got back at my alma mater several years ago when I was invited back to speak to the Student Government Association. The student, I hope she got it wrong when she introduced me as a man who deserves no introduction. I don't know, maybe she got it right. It's a pleasure for me to be here in San Francisco representing the American Bar Association, and I want to thank all of you for having me here today. I'm sure that you would expect me, of all people, to promote the valuable role that lawyers play in our society. But actually, it's the baseball fans here in your wonderful city, whether they're lawyers or not, that should understand this better than most. As the ABA's incoming president, my predecessor, Bill Newcomb, had the honor of speaking here at the Commonwealth Club in 2007, and soon after he finished his term as ABA president a year ago, he took over as the managing partner of the Giants. We were very happy with Bill's leadership of the ABA, and his leadership of the newly contending Giants is certainly promising. It's great, of course, to talk about sports, but I'm really here to discuss justice in these challenging times. As you can tell from my accent, I'm from the South. I'm particularly from Birmingham, Alabama. As it turns out, I'm not the first ABA president from Alabama. I'm actually the third. The second was my law partner, Lee Cooper, 12 years ago. But the first, as the Chinese curse puts it, lived in interesting times. It seems the first ABA president from Alabama was a real estate lawyer of national renown named Henry Upson Sims. As luck would have it, Mr. Sims served as our association's leader from 1929 to 1930. Obviously, the parallels between his leadership of the ABA during those times and mine are pretty evident. At times this year, I felt like I've been channeling the spirit of Henry Upson Sims in the economic times that we're facing. But Mr. Sims gave a speech at the ABA's annual meeting in 1930, just as the Great Depression was, of course, getting traction. And he told the assembled there at the ABA meeting, and I quote, "Visions of social strife are but phantasmagoria of morbid brains." Well, if Henry Upson Sims was an optimist, he certainly wasn't a wordsmith. I'm an optimist too, and I sure hope to spare you from phrases like phantasmagoria of morbid brains. But if I'm an optimist, it's not because we as lawyers turned a blind eye to social strife. It's because we believe that our system of government, our system of laws, the legal profession, and our justice system help us manage and hopefully resolve the societal issues that we face. Our government is dealing with so many major issues that at times it can be mind-boggling. The economic crisis, energy development and conservation, affordable health care, the fight against terrorism, and balancing that with preserving civil liberties. Other civil rights issues involving marriage, families, voting, and you could go on. The list is, of course, almost endless. But we expect our government to confront and resolve these problems, and this requires every branch of government, each separate but co-equal branch, to fulfill its unique constitutional role and to act with resolve and common purpose. What are those roles? We all know the basics. Congress and state legislatures enact laws. The executive branch enforces laws, and the judiciary interprets laws. Our system of justice was elegantly described by the late Senator Sam Ervin as the most essential safeguard of a free society. And I can attest from my own travels abroad and the experience of the ABA's international rule of law programs that our judiciary and system of justice are admired, envied, and emulated by many others around the world. And this applies not only to our federal courts, which arguably get the lion's share of public attention, especially at the Supreme Court level, but also to our state courts, which actually hear the overwhelming majority of cases in this country. It is therefore crucial that Americans are aware of and appreciate the role of independent, fair, and impartial courts. When we're talking about judicial independence, we are really referring to two forms of independence. The first is institutional independence. By this, we mean that the judiciary is a third branch of government, independent of the other two. Institutional independence enables the judiciary to check over-concentrations of power in the other two political branches. Then there's decisional independence, guaranteeing judges life tenure during good behavior and an undiminished salary while in office enables them to make rulings based on the Constitution and the law, even if those decisions are unpopular or contrary to the political expediencies of the day. Though life tenure is a hallmark of the federal courts, this is generally not the case with state courts whose judges are selected, or worse, elected, in ways that vary widely by state and jurisdiction. Some forms of judicial selection preserve this element of judicial independence better than others. I'd like to clear up one popular misunderstanding, however. Judicial independence does not mean that judges are free to do as they please, or that the judiciary is not accountable to and dependent upon the executive and legislative branches. For one thing, the decisions of all judges are subject to review and reversal, first by higher courts. And even decisions of the highest court of the land, the Supreme Court, can be remedied by legislation, or if necessary, by constitutional amendment. Aside from the appellate and legislative process, judges are also held accountable in another important way by the codes of judicial ethics that ensure the legitimacy of their actions. The Constitution also gives the political branches broad powers over the judiciary, including the power to nominate, confirm, and even impeach and remove federal judges for high crimes and misdemeanors. The legislative branch also has the power to regulate court jurisdiction and make laws necessary and proper for the exercise of these powers, including setting the salaries of judges and providing funding for court operations. Our system of checks and balances creates a purposeful tension between judicial independence and accountability that makes some interbranch friction inevitable. If that friction is maintained within manageable limits, this tension is not so much a cause for concern as a sign that our Constitution is functioning as intended by the drafters. Too much friction, on the other hand, can impede the work of government. Let's take a look at how the interplay between the branches works, especially the crucial role that an independent judiciary plays. I'd like to do so by examining some difficult issues raised by anti-terrorism policies instituted after the 2001 terrorist attacks. You've probably heard of at least some of the cases over the years, but it can be confusing to keep all the names and the issues straight. It does, however, help to have an overview from today's perspective. After 9/11, the president declared that terrorism suspects would be considered what the administration termed enemy combatants. In a series of orders in 2001 and 2002, the executive branch created tribunals that did not adhere to the Geneva Conventions or to the existing Code of Military Justice. Arguing that as non-state actors, these enemy combatants were not entitled to that kind of protection, the executive also declared the system to be beyond review by the federal courts. The government obviously also established the prison camp at Guantanamo Bay to hold these prisoners away from federal court jurisdiction, arguing that the right of habeas corpus, the fundamental right, centuries old, predating our Constitution, to ask a judge for release from unjust imprisonment did not apply to foreigners being held outside the United States as enemy combatants. It's important to point out that the courts can't simply jump into these issues themselves unless a case or controversy is properly brought before them. The federal courts became involved because lawsuits were filed on behalf of the detainees challenging the terms of their detention. One of those cases was Raisel versus Bush, which the Supreme Court decided in 2004. In that case, the court ruled that the executive branch lacked the authority to deny Guantanamo detainees access to the U.S. justice system. It determined that the federal courts did have jurisdiction under the federal habeas statute to hear suits by Guantanamo detainees challenging the legality of their detention. Another case that year was Hamdi versus Rumsfeld, which involved the indefinite detention of an American citizen who had been captured and deemed an enemy combatant in Afghanistan. The Supreme Court in Hamdi ruled that U.S. citizens being held indefinitely as enemy combatants must be given a meaningful opportunity to challenge the basis of their detention. In this case, their classification as an enemy combatant before a neutral, independent decision maker. Following these rulings, the Department of Defense established tribunals for detainees to contest their status as enemy combatants. In 2005, Congress got into the act by passing the Detainee Treatment Act, which restricted detainees from initiating habeas corpus petitions, instead replacing it with a limited judicial review of combatant status determinations. This act also prohibited the use of torture, explicitly stating that all persons held captive anywhere in the world by the United States are protected against torture. In June 2006, in a case called Hamdan versus Rumsfeld, the Supreme Court struck down military tribunals, ruling that they had not been established by statute, that they violated the Uniform Code of Military Justice, and they also violated the Geneva Conventions. The court reminded the executive branch that no matter what independent powers the president may have, he cannot disregard existing statutes enacted by Congress. There was more give and take among the branches of government. In response to the Hamdan ruling, the Bush administration and Congress enacted the Military Commissions Act of 2006. In place of habeas corpus proceedings, detainees could challenge their imprisonment only through combatant status review trials. It allowed evidence seized in the U.S. or abroad without a search warrant, and it also allowed hearsay evidence to be admitted in these trials. And while the bill barred the admission of evidence obtained by cruel and inhuman treatment, it made an exception for any such evidence obtained prior to December 30th, 2005. Why that particular date? That's the date when Congress banned torture in the Detainee Treatment Act. And finally, we had the combined case of Boumediene versus Bush and Al Oda versus United States decided at the conclusion of the Supreme Court's term a year ago. The court held that the constitutionally guaranteed right of habeas corpus review applies to people held in Guantanamo and to people designated as enemy combatants there. This past November, five detainees who filed habeas corpus petitions were ordered freed by a federal district court in Washington, D.C. Some other detainees likewise have since been ordered freed. I speak of these cases to demonstrate the interplay of the three branches of government in determining the balance between our national security and our civil liberties, especially as it relates to the crucial role that our courts play. But focusing on these cases and issues, of course, has its limitations. Federal cases are only a small, in fact, a very small sliver of what America's courts actually deal with day after day. There's a reason for the expression, don't make a federal case out of it. At least 95% of all of the cases in America's courts are handled not by federal courts, certainly not by the U.S. Supreme Court, but by state courts. And just as we know with federal courts, it's crucial to maintain independent state judiciaries as well. The issue of independent state courts has been made all the more crucial in the recent interesting times we live in, not because of national security issues, but because of money. For one thing, the recession has affected the operation of courts, quite frankly, in disturbing ways. Hardly a week passes without news of another jurisdiction severely curtailing criminal, civil, or juvenile justice programs due to revenue shortfalls. Here in California, for example, the judicial branch budget was reduced by $256 million in the just-ended fiscal year, and the judicial branch is facing a $676 million reduction this year. Add that up, that's almost a $1 billion reduction. If debate over national security and personal liberties is an indication that we're living in interesting times, the recession is, of course, a major one too. Reduced funding for the judiciary is especially troubling when the economic crisis is creating more work, not less, for the courts, with cases involving foreclosures, debt management, unemployment claims, evictions, and other problems that affect millions of Americans every day. The organized bar always does a great deal of pro bono publico work to try to close the gap in access to justice, but quite frankly, there's only so much that private lawyers can do. As it is, 73% of all lawyers report having volunteered their services to people with limited incomes in the past year, a volunteerism rate far greater than any other profession. The justice funding crisis was the principal issue for a national summit the ABA recently convened on fair and impartial state courts. Delegations were sent by the chief justices of 37 state and territorial Supreme Courts, including California's, indicating how much the issue is resonating throughout the country. These delegations represented all three branches of state government and justice system leadership, and they developed strategies to maintain adequate justice system budgets and ensure the court's institutional legitimacy by promoting communication, cooperation, and collaboration among the three branches of state government. Sadly, as we learned, in too many states, separation of powers has meant an iron wall of separation, creating a mistrust that leads to ignorance of the crucial role of the judicial branch in our system of government. Aside from financial resource issues, courts face challenges to their independence in other ways. One involves how too many states select their judges. They do so not according strictly to their qualifications as jurists, but by a political, electoral free-for-all that gorges on money. Though this isn't an immediate problem in California, a courts commission here identified the problem as one California citizens should continually monitor, lest it become a problem here. In my home state of Alabama, as in other states, we elect most of our state court judges in partisan elections. Unfortunately, these have become highly politicized judicial elections, which, in my opinion, undermine public confidence in a fair and impartial judiciary. As Justice Sandra Day O'Connor has said, and I will quote her, "While our judiciary has always faced significant attacks, some appropriate and others not, the single greatest threat to judicial independence is fairly modern and uniquely American, and that is the flood of money coming into our courtrooms by way of increasingly expensive and volatile judicial elections. I think it's important to emphasize that. The single greatest threat to judicial independence is fairly modern and uniquely American. In the election in Alabama that we just had, candidates for the open Alabama Supreme Court seat, together with an outside interest group, spent almost $5 million in the race. It was the most expensive Supreme Court election in the country that year. This situation is shameful. National polls show that 3 in 4 Americans believe that campaign contributions affect judges' decisions. There's a story you may be familiar with. This one is not from Alabama, but from West Virginia. It's a true story, although it reads an awful lot like a John Grisham novel. A while back, a little-known candidate for the state Supreme Court in West Virginia was running against an incumbent justice. The candidate was the beneficiary of a $3 million campaign contribution from the chief executive officer of a coal mining company. The contribution was a substantial portion of all of the campaign money on that candidate's behalf, and he, in fact, won the election, beating the incumbent. Soon thereafter, the newly elected justice provided the deciding vote in overturning a $50 million verdict against the same coal mining company. Last fall, the issue reached the U.S. Supreme Court in a case called Caperton versus Massey Coal, where the court was asked to rule on whether the justice should have removed himself from considering the case. Just a few weeks ago, our country scored a victory for an independent state judiciary when the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that the losing litigant's constitutional rights of federal due process were violated when the justice who received that extraordinary campaign contribution heard and ruled on the case. As Justice Kennedy's majority opinion reminded us, no one should be allowed to serve as a judge in his or her own case. This, in effect, is what the winning litigant did by bankrolling the justice's campaign victory. So, what does the future hold when it comes to the role of a vibrant, independent judiciary? In the federal courts, as we've discussed, our nation's fight against terrorism continues to raise difficult legal issues that independent courts will decide. We're also sure to see decisions on other policies of the executive and review of legislation involving the economy, labor and employment, civil rights, social issues like same-sex marriage, and just about everything you read in the headlines. Frenchman Alexis de Tocqueville famously observed this in his classic 19th century account of our new nation, democracy in America. Contrasting us to Europe, he wrote that every societal issue eventually works its way to and gets resolved peacefully in our courts. Independent, fair, and impartial courts, I might add. That's true whether you're talking about heady federal issues like terrorism detention or state secrets litigation, or more novel and sometimes mundane issues like who, according to the law, gets to keep Barry Bonds' home run baseball. As for our state courts, particularly here, I'd refer you to California's Commission for Impartial Courts, which was formed by Chief Justice George and is chaired by Associate Justice Ming Chen of the California Supreme Court. The commission is studying and recommending ways to ensure judicial impartiality and accountability for the benefit of all Californians. They're looking at judicial selection and retention, judicial candidate campaign conduct, judicial campaign finance, and public information and education. What's really promising, I think, is that the commission's membership includes not only appellate justices and trial court judges, but also court executive officers, prominent former members of the legislature, and leaders of the bar, media, law schools, the business community, educational institutions, and civic groups. Discussions like this frame the issues before us not as problems for the courts, but as problems for and the responsibility of all of us as citizens. The Commonwealth Club does an excellent job of bringing such issues to our attention, and I thank you for allowing me to contribute to these discussions with you tonight. Thank you very much.
Our thanks to H. Thomas Wells, President of the American Bar Association. I'm Goodwin Liu, Associate Dean and Professor of Law at the UC Berkeley School of Law, and having successfully negotiated the Bay Bridge traffic, I will be moderating today's audience question period. Let me move to the main mic and give you a chance to sit down, and I'll ask the question standing up, and you can have this one. So we've got a lot of questions, so why don't we get started? The first batch of questions concerns Sonia Sotomayor. Next week, we will see democracy in action, beginning with her confirmation hearings before the Senate Judiciary Committee, the Senate exercising its advising consent authority under the U.S. Constitution. This just recently, the American Bar Association issued a well-qualified rating upon reviewing her record. Let me just dive right in and ask you, Mr. Wells, one of the issues that is going to be front and center in that hearing is her remark that her ethnic heritage is an asset in evaluating her approach or her record as a nominee. Should a person's ethnic heritage matter in a person's candidacy for a judgeship?
Well, obviously, that's going to be an issue, as is the whole question of empathy, the so-called empathy debate. The ABA, first of all, does not rate candidates on empathy or ethnicity. We rate candidates only on professional competence, integrity, and judicial temperament. It was on those three criteria that the ABA Standing Committee on Federal Judiciary gave Judge Sotomayor a well-qualified rating. It's important to note, I think, in talking about the ABA rating process for federal judges, that number one, we don't do it just for Supreme Court judges. We do it for any judge, any Article III judge who is nominated for a lifetime appointment. But we do it as a peer review. It is not just the members, the 15 members of our standing committee's view that Judge Sotomayor is well qualified. It is the peer review of literally hundreds of lawyers, judges, and other colleagues that have had dealings with Judge Sotomayor during her tenure as a lawyer, as a U.S. District Court judge, and as a Court of Appeals judge. And so it's really the only peer review process that is involved, and we try to keep it as being non-ideological. Now, what the Senate Judiciary Committee does with it is obviously up to the Senate Judiciary Committee.
Just to piggyback off that point, so of course, I think all of us expect that our judges will be fair and impartial and independent in the ways that you've laid out, but a few of our questioners observe that ideology is undoubtedly on display in the U.S. Supreme Court. We have 9 members of the court who vary quite a lot in terms of how they see the law. We have a left, we have a right. And so why shouldn't ideology matter? Why shouldn't the Senate Judiciary Committee ask about a nominee's ideology and, in essence, penetrate to that issue?
Well, you know, that's been a debate, and it's one of the tensions between the branches of government that we've talked about a bit tonight. You know, if you go back historically, It's not that long ago that the Senate Judiciary Committee didn't hold hearings on judicial nominees. They simply went in and voted, and usually with no controversy. So it's a relatively modern phenomenon for the hearings to take on, unfortunately, sometimes the level of spectacle that we have seen with some of the recent confirmation issues.
There's a number of questions about Guantanamo. So just a few weeks ago, President Obama set forth his framework for how he's going to deal with Guantanamo and getting it closed within the first year of his term in office. And the tenor of his approach has generally been to be, as he has put it, forward-looking rather than backward-looking. And yet, at the same time, some people have suggested that it's important to hold accountable those who sort of led us into that quagmire. Does the ABA, or do you have a position on whether or not accountability should be demanded of the decision makers who created the Guantanamo situation? And if so, what form should that accountability take?
Well, first, let me say, the ABA, except when we file amicus briefs, we normally don't comment on pending cases. And obviously, there is a pending case involving John Yoo and the legal advice and policy advice that he gave as an administration lawyer. The ABA does not have a specific position on accountability per se. We do have a position that all of the facts need to be investigated and revealed in terms of what happened and basically how we got here. When you get into the situation of, should you hold a lawyer accountable for bad legal advice outside the context of a malpractice claim, if you look at the law, the cases on that, it is not unprecedented for a government lawyer to be held civilly responsible for giving bad legal advice when serving as a government lawyer, but it's a pretty high standard. It almost has to be that no reasonable lawyer in that position could possibly give that advice. The case that I recall was one where Department of Homeland Security lawyers in a situation where property had been seized gave advice to the that before the property was released, the government could require a release be given to the government. Well, there was no authority for that whatsoever, and the lawyers, at least on an initial look, were not dismissed from the case and had to go forward and defend. So, it's a tough issue in terms of accountability, and I think we need to walk some pretty fine lines between discouraging people from entering public service and yet holding people accountable if, in fact, the facts show that it was really a subterfuge and not valid good faith legal advice.
The president's legal framework for dealing with Guantanamo also includes a very difficult category of persons who he has said are dangerous, but cannot be tried through ordinary legal process, whether in the criminal courts of the United States or whether through military commissions or some other process for any number of reasons. And for those people, he proposes a system of preventative detention with certain safeguards built in. Is a system of preventative detention consistent with the rule of law?
Oh boy, that's, gee, why don't you ask me a hard question? it is going to depend on the process. When you get to the rule of law, the heart of the rule of law is due process. I have been to Guantanamo. I have seen the detention facility there. By all look, when I was there 2 years ago, it was an extraordinarily well-run prison, but it was still a prison. It's not somewhere you would want to spend a lot of time. You certainly wouldn't want to spend an indefinite amount of time there, and thus far, many of the people at Guantanamo have been there well over 5 years. I think it's a very tricky situation to try to establish an indefinite detention without charges consistent with the rule of law.
You mentioned institutional independence as one of the dimensions of independence of the judiciary. Some recent accounts of the court, the Supreme Court in particular, have suggested that the court's decisions tend in the aggregate towards the middle of the road. In other words, the court never strays very far from the center of public opinion. It's summarized by a phrase that the decisions of the court tend to follow the election returns. And one might make this case based on looking at the court's jurisprudence on abortion, sort of, you know, in the middle on that, on affirmative action, somewhat in the middle on that, on gay rights, somewhat in the middle on that. Is it really, I mean, this is not to say that the court is consciously looking at poll results, but what do you think accounts for the end product of the, at least the Supreme Court, never straying radically far from what the middle of America will accept?
Well, I think there have been instances where the court has certainly strayed away from what you would consider the middle of at least certain commonly held beliefs. If you simply look back to the Brown versus Board of Education decision, which was probably one of the most interesting from a not just the legal standpoint and the precedent that it set, but the fact that it ended up being a unanimous decision. When you look at the underlying judicial politics, internal judicial politics, if you will, for a decision like that, it showed extraordinary courage, and it actually changed, I think, public opinion to a large extent, rather than following public opinion. So I'm not sure that that the court always simply follows the middle road. There are some times when it strikes out and takes a decidedly unpopular, at least in some circles, unpopular stance. I think some of their decisions involving the Guantanamo detainees were certainly not middle of the road in terms of, you know, there are quite a number of citizens in the United States who would be just as happy if no one ever left Guantanamo.
Here's a question from our internet audience. Should former U.S. Attorney General Alberto Gonzalez be allowed to practice law?
Well, as long as he has a law license and it hasn't been taken away by the state that he's licensed in, he certainly is entitled to practice law. Lawyer discipline is not handled on the national level. It is handled on the local level with state bar associations.
You mentioned the problem of elected judges, which is, of course, an issue that arises with respect to state judges, since federal judges are not elected. What can be done to change that problem, apart from the sort of constitutional constraints, for example, that you mentioned that the Supreme Court put in the Caperton case? That's, the court itself said, was sort of an extreme situation. What can be done sort of more about the central part of the problem, which is the closeness of the judges to the demands of the public and the pressures they face for election, which, as you, I'm sure you know, Californians are very familiar with in our own history.
Certainly. Obviously, one thing that can be done is to go to a merit selection process similar to what's been historically called the Missouri Plan, where a commission basically takes applications for a judgeship and gives the governor a list of approved names, and the governor picks one of those, and then that judge could stand for a retention election after some period of time. Those retention elections have become perhaps better in more recent times that because we've had judicial evaluation, performance evaluations that have been instituted in various states. Clearly, though, there are some states that are not going to move away from the initial election of judges. There are simply better ways to do it than in partisan elections. Number one, you can move to nonpartisan elections. Number two, the elephant in the room in judicial elections is campaign contributions. North Carolina a few years ago went to a public funding of appellate judges, which has worked extraordinarily well and takes the money out. If there is a better way to take the money out, I haven't seen it, but that's where the problem is. It's not per se with the election. It is with the idea that the public is simply going to perceive that if a lot of money is given to a judicial candidate to run for judge, then they are nothing more than ordinary politicians who happen to wear robes.
I have another question from our internet audience, and it's a historical question. How well do you think our judiciary has performed in the wake of 9/11 compared to other times of crisis, for example, the Civil War, World War II, or Watergate?
Gee, those are some interesting comparisons. Without making a comparison, I think in terms of the judiciary's performance post 9/11, I think they've performed extraordinarily well. I think they have upheld the rule of law and told the executive that there are limits to executive power even in these extraordinary times. Obviously, there were perhaps greater issues at stake during the Civil War, which perhaps led to some more unfortunate decisions of the courts, including suspension of habeas corpus and other things like that.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is H. Thomas Wells, the president of the American Bar Association, who is discussing challenges to preserving the integrity of the American judicial system. I have another question, and it's a broad question, which is, how has the economy affected the economic crisis affected the legal profession?
Well, the legal profession has been affected just like every other aspect of the economy. There have been layoffs of lawyers and people who work in law firms. And in some respects, it's been perhaps more shocking to lawyers this particular recession than others, because lawyers typically have a counter-cyclical backdrop. Portions of practice will go up when the economy goes down. Bankruptcy is a good example. But it appears that in this particular recession, my own personal view just from traveling around the country is that lawyers got a bit overextended, just like businesses got overextended in terms of leverage, in terms of exposure to the capital markets, and in terms of exposure to rather more exotic financial instruments, and therefore are now bearing the brunt of the collapse in those particular markets.
Another question about terrorism. If Osama bin Laden were caught alive, where would he be tried?
Well, that's a good question. Probably depends on who catches him and where.
Suppose we catch him.
I think there's certainly a possibility he could be tried to a military commission under the auspices of the Military Commissions Act. On the other hand, if you look at the example that our friends in Great Britain have set, they have been extraordinarily successful, I think, in trying alleged terrorist in their criminal court system. And that could certainly be a possibility. We have successfully tried other terrorists. If you think about the first attempted bombings of the World Trade Centers, those terrorists were tried in federal district court very successfully. And I think you would certainly have those options available.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We have a few questions about globalization. Do you think that international legal norms or the laws of other nations or the decisions of courts in other nations should affect how American jurists interpret American law?
Well, I certainly think it's a potential source to look at the way other nations are deciding similar issues. It's certainly not controlling, but I see nothing wrong with, for example, looking to the Canadian Supreme Court if there's an issue that comes before the U.S. Supreme Court, if they happen to have dealt with that issue in a similar vein. If you look around the world, the court that is most cited by other national courts is the United States Supreme Court.
Another issue that's raised, I think, also by the Sotomayor nomination, somewhat indirectly, which is how would you evaluate the diversity of the legal profession today, especially the upper ranks of the legal profession in terms of lawyers who are partners in law firms or judges? Has there been progress on those dimensions, and where progress has been short, what more could be done?
Well, number one, there has been progress. Number two, there has not been nearly enough progress. The legal profession, unfortunately, does not look like the society we're called upon to serve very much. If you look at the various aspects of diversity, and within the American Bar Association, we have a very broad tent under the term diversity. We include not only racial and ethnic diversity, but the situation with women, with lawyers with disabilities, and lawyers with differing sexual orientations or gender identities. We don't do as good as other professions in promoting diversity. Where we've done the best, at least in terms of numbers, is with women. At least half of the lawyers graduating from law schools now are female, or as my daughter reminds me, non-males. My daughter, who happens to be a lawyer, by the way. But those women are facing other challenges in terms of rising the ranks of the profession. And we're not doing a good enough job, I don't think, in racial and ethnic diversity. It's more difficult in dealing with lawyers with disabilities and with sexual orientation and gender identity issues because of the reluctance sometimes of individuals to self-identify, particularly if the disability happens to be a mental disability. In those categories, so it's a little harder to judge. We've got a long way to go, but we at the American Bar Association are trying to do this. We had a national summit on the next steps for diversity just last month in Washington, D.C., where we had over 300 attendees from all across the country, and hopefully we'll come out with a report in August.
What you say about the graduating classes of law students is very striking, that there are more women than men. That's certainly true at my institution at Bolt Hall. I want to just ask a question about that, since you've had a very distinguished career in private practice. Are there changes happening in big law firms today that can accommodate work and family responsibilities in a more flexible fashion? A lot of women, it seems, rise through the ranks to a certain point and then are faced with very difficult choices with respect to their work and family roles, and many of them at that point sort of drop off before rising to the top ranks. Is there anything changing in that regard?
I really think there is, particularly in the law firms that I'm familiar with, where flex time is much easier to do. Fortunately, part of that is due to communications and technology. Telecommuting used to be, unheard of. It's relatively easy now. It used to be if you were going to practice law, you had to be in a place that had, 10,000 books so you could go look up the cases. There's no law firm in the country that I know now that has 10,000 books. We do it all online, which you can do at home just as easily as you could do in your law office. So I see some great possibilities there. I see a lot of firms encouraging that, and I certainly think that is a good way to go.
Another question that relates to the Sotomayor nomination. You mentioned judicial temperament. Can you say what is judicial temperament? And how should the Senate Judiciary Committee probe this very nebulous thing called judicial temperament?
Well, clearly judicial temperament is something that is going to be, to some extent, subjective. And again, we're talking about a peer review process. This is not just the 15 members of the standing committee trying to assess judicial temperament, but asking hundreds, literally hundreds of lawyers and judges, peers of Judge Sotomayor, as to whether she meets the judicial temperament standard. The way I've described it is perhaps a bit colloquial. There was a lawyer in Birmingham who was nominated to be a federal judge. He was walking across the Lynn Park in downtown Birmingham, and he ran into the chief state court judge, Judge McElroy. And Judge McElroy called him over and said, "Bill, I understand you've been nominated to be a federal judge." Bill said, "Yes, Judge McElroy, I have." And Judge McElroy said, "Well, Bill, I've seen many a fine person put on that black robe and turn into a real SOB. It's going to be interesting in your case, see if it works in reverse." I think that's my standard of judicial temperament.
Well put. You mentioned that 73% of lawyers that you surveyed had done pro bono work, which is an impressive figure. I'm just curious, and this is not to be facetious, but it is certainly the case that there is a genre of jokes called lawyer jokes in our society. Why is it, do you think, that lawyers are, among some people, not held in the highest esteem as a profession?
You know, if I could come up with the silver bullet to that, I could probably be ABA president for life, but...
What do you think feeds that perception, or is that really just a tongue-in-cheek thing? Is there any seriousness behind?
I think there, behind any sort of joke, there's always a germ of truth to it. Unfortunately, there are times when lawyers do things that are not exactly seemly, and those get highlighted. In my opinion, one of the worst things that has happened to the image of the legal profession was the allowance of lawyer advertising. And I think that, if you look back, I think you saw the rise in lawyer jokes correspond to the increase in lawyer advertising. Obviously, it became a free speech issue, but I still remember sitting in a subway car in New York City and looking around the top, and it said, "Need a lawyer? Call 1-800-GOOD-LAWYER. And I started counting it up. G-O-O-D. That's too many numbers.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is H. Thomas Wells, the president of the American Bar Association. I have a few more questions that are about various and sundry topics. Let me just read a couple of them. One says, Justice Ginsburg has endorsed Sonia Sotomayor today in the New York Times in an interview that's published. Is this ethical?
I don't think there's anything unethical about it. I think she's got the same right of free speech as anyone else. I think about the same as former Justice Sandra Day O'Connor saying that she was very pleased that a woman was nominated, and I certainly don't see any ethical lapses in that.
Another question is concerning executive power, and certainly we've had that as a major point of controversy in the post 9/11 era. Isn't it going to be the case that in times of crisis that the president will be the sort of leading figure because there's a unity of command, a single voice, and over time, although the framers of our Constitution didn't necessarily set it up this way because the president, after all, is Article II, Congress was sort of the preeminent authority, so they thought, the President of the United States has emerged as sort of the leading figure of the government. Does that need to be recalibrated, or is that just a fact of life that both the judiciary and the Congress need to accommodate themselves to?
Well, I think it's simply, it's more a fact of modern life. It's much easier for a single executive to get a message across than a, 435-member House and 100-member Senate. And in this day of communication, you're going to always see, I think, the single single voice, if you will. I think it's simply a matter it's a matter of life that that the courts and Congress have to figure out how to deal with. Now, that being said, that doesn't mean that Congress can't pass laws that limit executive power, and it doesn't mean that the courts can strike down exercises of executive power that are beyond the pale.
Another question. How can young people entering the judicial and legal fields today help to preserve the American justice system, and are law schools doing their part to shape students into ethical members of the profession?
Well, I certainly hope they are. I know all law schools now teach ethics, and I think that is something that clearly needs to be emphasized. I've said before that people who go into law as a job or a business are in it for the wrong reason. We have a relatively quaint saying in the South, if you become a lawyer, we say you were called to the bar. I think we need to try to emphasize that to law students, that it is, in fact, a calling. And if you think about it, the only other profession that is referred to as a calling is the clergy. Engineers are not called to engineering. Accountants are not called to accountancy. And dentists are not called to dentistry. But lawyers are called to the bar. And as long as we view it as a calling, I think we're going to be in pretty good stead.
Another question concerns the death penalty. We have seen a number of Supreme Court cases in recent years sort of nibble at the scope of the death penalty, outlawing the death penalty for the mentally retarded, for defendants whose crimes were committed before they were of majority age. Is the end of the death penalty foreseeable within, say, the next few decades?
Not without some change in overall public opinion, in my estimation. The American Bar Association actually takes no position on the death penalty per se. However, we do believe that if a jurisdiction elects to use the ultimate punishment, that they need to do it with the most rigorous due process, simply because once you execute, you can't go back and undo it. Unfortunately, our review of the various jurisdictions that impose the death penalty has not found a single one that does it with sufficient due process rigor.
Another question concerns the legal services for indigent persons. For a number of years, the federal money for legal aid, essentially, has been embroiled in certain controversies about what legal aid lawyers do. They challenge laws, they push against the system, essentially, because they are representing people who tend to be on the disadvantaged side. What more could be done to give lawyers for indigent persons both more resources and free rein in terms of what they're doing in terms of representing people who need legal help?
Well, that's something the American Bar Association has been actively lobbying on for a number of years. First, on the money side, we got an additional $40 million appropriated in the current fiscal year for the Federal Legal Services Corporation. We also got a letter signed by every state bar association and territorial bar association favoring an increase of another $45 million in appropriations. The other part of that coin is every year in the appropriations bill for legal services, Congress has put certain restrictions in the appropriations on the types of cases that legal services attorneys can handle. We have also been actively lobbying to ease those restrictions. And it appears that in this Congress, we are first going to get some additional money for legal services and some relief from the restrictions on legal services lawyers.
Our hour has come to a close, and I want to ask you to join me in thanking H. Thomas Wells, the president of the American Bar Association, for a very informative and interesting hour of conversation. And we also thank our audiences here and on the radio, television, and the internet. Tonight's program has been part of the Commonwealth Club's U.S. Constitution in the 21st Century series, underwritten by the Charles Geschke family. I'm Professor Goodwin Liu of the Bolt Hall School of Law at UC Berkeley, and this meeting of the Commonwealth of California, celebrating more than a century of enlightened discussion, is adjourned.